Welcome to the Modern Health Show. This is fitness and nutrition expert Shawn Stevenson here with my amazing co-host and producer of the Modern Health Show, Jade Harrell. What's up, Jade?
What's going on, Shawn?
How are you today?
Today I am free-mendous.
Free-mendous? Mm-hmm. I like this direction we're going
Thank
already.
You.
Free-mendous.
Thank you.
What
yes.
is that?
I feel free and I'm allowing myself to be free and it's tremendous.
Yes, I like that.
Throw off the restraints.
Free-mendous.
Yes.
Hashtag Freemendous. I love it. Thank you. Everybody, thank you so much for tuning into the show today. We've got a very, very valuable and I'm really excited about this episode. And we're going to be talking about five things that kids can teach us about living a happy, healthy life. And I've got some studies that are going to blow your mind.
Okay.
And this is an important topic because we are oftentimes disconnected from that part of us, that essence. And we're going to break down these five different things and what those things are and how they can bring so much more vitality to our lives. And shout out to the kids.
Right.
Shout out to the kids listening. Mm-hmm. Shout out to the parents of kids. Shout out if you were ever a kid.
Right. So everybody should be
That's
shouting
everybody.
Right now, right.
If we didn't give right. aliens listening,
uh-huh.
shout out to you
Welcome
too.
Welcome to you
E.T.
too.
On home, baby. But first,
yeah.
got a quick shout out to our show sponsor, onnit.com. Look, today I had the Hemp Force Protein in my green smoothie. And it was a fantastic.
Okay.
All right, so let me just break off what
right,
I had.
Describe
so I had
that.
Huge, like huge handful of spinach that I threw uh-huh. into the blender. I did half of a banana.
Okay.
And this was on the strength of talking with Dr. Robin Chutkin,
mm-hmm.
all right, for the inulin. All right, half a banana. All right, half a banana.
Right.
And this is at post-workout, by the way.
Oh,
all right, so you got to be
I'm
careful with the bananas
cause...
because it's very, you know, it's the sugar bomb. It's not that we can't have it. Just got to be careful with that.
Well, we're talking about kids. So when you're thinking, yeah. I'm throwing a smoothie together.
But that inulin can be really helpful for those friendly floras.
Cool.
Too much sugar, though, can mm-hmm. be, you know, so again, just imbalance.
Converse.
But with those greens to help buffer that. And then I had some cinnamon
mm-hmm.
went in there. The vanilla acai hemp force protein went
That's
in there.
The one.
I did a little classic peanut butter. I had to go. I felt peanut butter had me feeling some kind of way today. So I went there and I did me a scoop of the peanut
okay.
butter.
Okay. All right.
And then some frozen blueberries to make it nice and cool. And I also threw in some Shilajit. You know, I'm always going to throw in some
How
little medicinal
that.
Thing
yeah.
in there as well. A little pinch of sea salt.
Mm.
Blended that bad boy up, and that's what I had today.
Miraculous. So. Now, where's my bottle?
You're sipping on something nice over there. We'll talk about later. We'll talk about that later. And you feeling, I see you feeling some kind of way
I
over
do.
There.
Do you
like,
see
what's
it?
In this? What is this?
Oh, God.
So,
but it's along the lines of how
yeah.
we have been enjoying very responsibly made and valuable
yeah.
ingredients in the things that we're taking in. So, you know, I'm a Choco Maca fan.
Yes, from the Hemp Force Protein.
Yeah.
So, guys, if you haven't tried the Hemp Force Protein yet, I don't know what you're waiting for.
Mm-hmm.
This is the best tasting hemp protein that you're going to find. And it's the food itself, it's an extremely high protein food in
mm-hmm.
nature versus something like brown rice. Not necessarily high in its protein construct in nature itself,
mm-hmm.
but it can be a great balancer for something like hemp. But hemp, the hemp seeds itself, 35% protein.
And you could see right? them in there. There's the full seeds. They threw in some of the full
yeah,
seeds
exactly.
in there.
Exactly. You're getting that. So you're getting those fatty acids,
mm-hmm.
super, super valuable omega-6s, omega-3s, great ratio, almost a perfect ratio for the human body that you'll find in hemp seeds. And so, yes, they've got that in there as well. Vanilla acai, Choco Maca, check them out. Onnit.com, onnit.com/model for 10% off. Now, let's get to the iTunes review of the week.
This is great. This is from TJLNM, and it says, an education, 5 stars. Shawn and Jade, first, thank you so much for all the time and effort you put in this show. I've been listening for several months now, and just the other day, I decided to start at show number one and listen to one every day. I worked as an RN on the oncology unit in a large, prestigious hospital before deciding to become a stay-at-home mom. I learned during this time that there are many things wrong with the way cancer is treated. Since that time, it's been sort of a hobby of mine to study wellness. I enjoy documentaries and books, and now I thoroughly enjoy your show. While listening to episode 3 yesterday, I found myself cheering as I heard what you had to say about breast cancer. I love your show. I wish what you say could be put on a loudspeaker for all to hear. I have an aptitude for learning, and you cause my cup to overflow. I also homeschool my kids, and they have become accustomed to hearing your voice. They may not understand everything you're saying, but it's getting in their heads nonetheless, and I'm grateful that we are all getting an education together. So thanks. Also, keeping your show mostly PG, keep up the good work. You're a light in this sometimes dark and scary world.
Oh, wow. Thank you. That means the world to me. It really, really does.
And that PG part was on purpose, too.
Mm-hmm. Yes, I know, because I can say a few things.
No,
but
you don't.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
And listen, that idea about having the megaphone so the mm-hmm. whole world could hear, immediately I thought about, like, Dr. Seuss book. Like, will Dr. Seuss,
long.
The Model Health Show out? Everybody yeah. can hear it. Thank you so much mm-hmm. for sharing that and to share your story. And it just really, really means a lot to me. And specifically, talking about episode 3, which we'll put in the show notes.
Great.
Very deep, mm-hmm. Passionate episode for us. Very early on in this venture with the Model Health Show. It's episode 3. But we came out of the gate strong mm-hmm. because we had this very strong foundation of things we were doing before starting the show. But there's a lot of life-changing, and this was a couple years ago.
Right.
I mean, stuff that people are just now starting to talk about in major media that you can find in that episode. Mm-hmm. So, everybody.
And then about her youngins, her babies,
yes.
right?
And of course, it is getting imbued.
I
and
love that.
She's going to specifically enjoy this episode, and everybody mm-hmm. really is going to get a lot from this one. And thank you again, everybody, for leaving those reviews on iTunes. Mm-hmm. Please keep them coming. If you've been waiting to leave the review, like, I'll get, do it.
Right.
Go do it now.
Just pause.
Totally, totally appreciate it. And hopefully we can get you a shout out on the show as well. So mm-hmm. on that note, let's go ahead and get to our topic
All
of the
right.
day. So today we're talking about the 5 things that kids can teach us about living a happy, healthy life.
Mm-hmm.
And this was really a catalyst. This show was brought about by watching my now 5-year-old son, Brayden, with this episode. His birthday is 2 days away. Jade's looking like, did I forget? No,
right, because I'm like, Sunday.
His birthday party's coming up, but yeah, it's okay.
There.
Relax.
I will not miss
but
my baby's birthday.
I've just been watching and witnessing and taking the opportunity to be with him and see this amazing experience of being a child, you know, because it can go by so quickly. And I know that many parents out there can identify with that. It's just like, where does the time go? But I promise you, it's so much more juicy and valuable when you just take the time to pay attention. And as I was just watching how he is in the world and his developing awareness and his developing, his innate sense
mm-hmm.
of
right.
self and place in this world, it started to spark all of these different ideas. And so that's what I'm going to share with you guys today, because they are very, very powerful.
Okay.
And there is some surprising kind of jaw-dropping research that's going to go along with this. So number one,
shout
let's go ahead.
Shout out to Brayden, number one, big 5-year-old Brayden.
Happy birthday,
happy
son.
Happy birthday, sweetie boy.
All right, so 5 things kids can teach us about living a happy, healthy
okay.
life. Number one thing that kids can teach us about living a happy and healthy life is they play full out.
Yes.
All right, kids play full out. It isn't half playing, all right? When they're playing, it's play time, game on. I'm all in it. And a lot of us, how often do you take plays off in your life? How often do you sit this one out? How often do you not even engage in the first place?
All the time.
All right? But when we're going to play, get in there and actually mix it up. Put yourself into it and be a part of that moment. You know, as we get older, we're so calculating. We're so reserved.
Yep.
And that is taking things away from you. And so let's talk a little bit about this. So number one, play itself. And I want to talk more about this subject mm-hmm. matter. Play itself is intimately tied to our overall health and well-being and our genetic expression. All right. Mm-hmm. So we're talking about printing out the best copies of yourself via your DNA. Play is tied to that. It literally keeps you youthful.
Good.
But we stop playing. We stop having fun. We stop putting our body and our mind in that state of play. So here's a really fascinating study. So Washington State University found that, and this is what the head researcher said, and I'll actually just quote him. So he said, we found that play activates the whole neocortex. And we found that of the 1,200 genes that we measured, about 1/3 of them were significantly changed simply by having a half hour of play. All right. Literally changing your genetic expression
mm-hmm.
by playing.
Mm-hmm.
All right. You don't hear that. Right. No. When you hear, I've got a gene for this problem, I've got a gene for that mm-hmm. problem. You don't hear that just by playing, mm-hmm. you can change your genetic expression.
Positively.
Very powerful. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. All right. So let this be the number one inspiration right there to print out the best copies of yourself, to be the best version of yourself. Play right. is mandatory.
Right.
All right. So
what
we
if
have to give ourselves permission.
How? Mm. I've gotten so far away from it. And now I'm so serious or so off into my adultness that I've lost track of
that. You just said two powerful words. Mm-hmm. Number one, serious.
Yeah.
All right. My mother-in-law really, when she said this statement, it really hit me. She said that seriousness is a sickness. And I started to analyze and realize places in my life where I had lost touch with just a pure, lively essence about things and gotten so serious about certain things.
Right.
And the reality is everything in this life is very malleable and changeable. And to get attached to any one thing with this sense of seriousness can put you in a very, very troubling mm-hmm. spot because we're not in control of anything past your fingertips.
Say that. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But of course, if you get into quantum physics and,
oh,
you know,
see?
I'm saying, you know, but generally, this is how it is.
That makes
you know?
Sense.
And so where have you allowed yourself to become sick mm-hmm. and lost touch with play and being more lighthearted? Because in the other thing was, did you say adultness?
I said adultness.
I use this term. I don't know if you've heard me say, I don't know if I said it on the show before, but I'm adulting.
Right? Right.
And I've been posting that a little bit, but in a more playful way.
Okay.
Right? But our adultness, we think because we graduated from high school or something, that all of a sudden we're grown up and
we've
supposed to abandon
hair.
Things. Right. And I remember the time for my son, Jordan, who's just turning 16, when he was about, I'd say 10 years old. All right. And this is right when Brayden was first coming into the world. Mm-hmm. And Jordan was like, he was having a conversation with my wife and she was like, one day you're not going to want to play with all these toys. And he was like, really? Like, why?
He couldn't.
He was like, I'm never going to stop playing with my toys.
Right.
Cut to
today,
a year later. Right. Like, he's just like, not girls, video games. Well, back
hair.
Then he was trying to be on those video games. But now he's all about his performance.
Mm-hmm.
He's studying.
Mm-hmm.
He's working on himself. And of course, he's got his eyes open for the ladies
right,
out there.
Right.
Oh, for the lady. All right. I don't want to get him in trouble if he's in a relationship.
Too late. They're looking at him too.
So we start to, of course, there's a natural part of it. We become interested in other things.
Mm-hmm.
But what's so interesting about Jordan is that he still has this playful nature about all of it.
Right.
And I'm so grateful because I don't know if I didn't consciously imbue that in him.
Mm-hmm.
I accidentally did something good
right.
to where he's very playful in that spirit. And my daughter as well.
Yeah.
My daughter has that same thing. And people don't know this when they see my kids, when they really get to know and see how goofy they are, that I had anything to do with this, you know? But very early on, I am conscious about this, though. Like, if we go to a grocery store, like, we're going to play. Like, we're going to be messing around in a cart. We're going
right.
to be, you know,
so
we're just going to have fun.
Right.
I mean, I let them know they can have fun anywhere. Mm-hmm. But of course, and what so many people come and say to me is that your kids are so well-behaved. I didn't even know they're there. They also know how to adapt mm-hmm. to situations and circumstances. It's not like they're just wild people jumping up on a table. You know, it's just being more of a conscious parent and imbuing that it's okay to be happy and to be playful and to have fun. And, of course, to keep this stuff in perspective as
exactly,
well.
Exactly. Exactly. So what I think happens is we get out of the yes environment that we were used to. You know, as kids, I could go here, I could touch that, I could dream about this. And we entered into a no environment. No, you can't do this. No, this isn't all right. No, that's out of your reach. And no, surrounded you and created these blockages. So then you start to withdraw, you know. So what I try to do with the children, you know, and there are some places, you know, you can't go into the glass house and play football. So there are some places. Stop jumping on your grandma's couch. I get that. But what I try to do deliberately is get us in big open spaces and where there's plenty of room to say yes, go all out, have this yes environment and be the kid you want to be. And they're like, come on, mom. I'm like, oh, You know, they remind me that I do have permission to do it too, you know.
Absolutely. Mm. And I love that. And I see that too with your kids. You know, they have more freedom in their play, and you're just like, yes, always, you know, you gotta, right. It's the balance, but they do, and they have that essence, and it's really refreshing to see. And so here's some other fascinating research with this. So another study found that play improves memory and stimulates the growth of the cerebral cortex. All right. So there's a lot of gray matter here, all right? So this gray matter was once thought to not, listen to the name, all right? It sounds so whatever, it's just filled with something. But we're talking about very important dynamic matter, this myelin that helps to insulate and protect your nerve transmission, number one, and also helps nerve transmissions to fire faster. Mm-hmm. So whether it's you're training for a particular sport, you become better at it, or mental gymnastics, right. You know, your education, your learning, that gray matter has a place because it makes all of that stuff insulated and protected. So play improves memory and stimulates growth of cerebral cortex. Another study, this was super, of course, geeking out a little bit, but play and exploration triggered the secretion of more brain-derived neurotrophic factor, right? The BDNF. And we've talked about this several times on the show. So this is a substance that's essential for growth and differentiation of your new neurons and synapses. So the synaptic clefts and connections. So basically how your brain is getting wired up, all right? This play and exploration helps that happen. And also BDNF is neuroprotective. So protecting your neurons, and that's kind of important.
Yeah, a little bit. Quick, throw me a scavenger hunt.
Right. Let's do this.
Yeah. Let's go. I call Sean.
That
you know, you pick teams.
You try
to get in there first.
Also, so another study found that kids actually pay more attention to academic tasks when they're given frequent but brief opportunities for free play.
For sure. Right? I've seen that.
We, same thing. You're just an adult baby. You're a
big baby.
Grown up adult baby. All right. And it was the same basic wiring. So what they found was that it wasn't necessarily when they're having these breaks about them just being able to play for a long time. They actually found that short recesses of 10 to 20 minutes tops were incredibly effective for when they're coming back and they're performing better on tests, right? The tests that they're giving them. Mm-hmm. Versus 30 minutes plus recess found that the opposite effects start to happen. All right, so they got a little bit more disconnected from that intention of doing this academic stuff. So giving yourself some frequent breaks to play can actually improve your focus. Mm-hmm. All right, and couldn't you use a little bit more focus in your life?
I could use a lot bit more.
A little bit more focus, a little less cyber loafing.
Right. All right. Well, some people think that's play. So what's your take on that? Mm. You know, is it... I'm going to go on and do a couple games of Galaga or...
We're talking about physical play. Okay. And actually, let me go ahead and tell you exactly why. It's like you have that ESPN or something.
I do. Me and you wired.
It's really ESPN.
I know. All right. Just like...
The leader in sports. So, all right. So this was conducted at the University of Texas at Dallas. Fascinating right here. They found that it's really critical for us to try new things in combination with this kind of playful demeanor that we're talking about, being physical, that physicality. So they found that play actually keeps the brain young. And the lead researcher, Denise Park, said that it seems it is not enough just to get out and do something. It is important to get out and do something that is unfamiliar and mentally challenging and that provides broad stimulation mentally and socially. Right.
Okay.
We do have online video games.
Right.
All right. We do have that kind of component, but the physicality just isn't there. And this isn't beating down video games. Shout out to Mario Brothers.
Right. Go.
Shout out to Pitfall.
Mario.
All the way back to the Atari.
Oh man.
My uncle had an Atari.
Yes.
Pitfall was the jam.
I did too.
The peanut butter and jam. So
here's
the
Pong.
Thing. We're talking about physicality. We're talking about play.
Yeah.
We're talking
about
getting out and being in your body.
Hide and seek. Right?
So this is actually what's considered active learning. Mm-hmm. Right? Active learning is when you're getting out and being physical. And so it's not just play. We label it as play, and it sounds good. Like, I want to play. But for that more hard, cemented person. Like, I'm adulting.
Right.
This is actually training. Mm-hmm. Right. This is active learning for you. Okay. So if you could maybe even change your reference point to what that looks like, if you're like, I don't play.
Right.
Homie, don't play that. Man, you
full of sand.
Shout out to In Living Color. All right. More so that's number one, guys. And this is just the first one of these five specific things that kids can teach us about living a happy, healthy life.
Love it.
Make time for play. All right. Make time to play. Whether it's with your friends, whether it's with your significant other, whether it's with your kids. Kids make this so much easier.
Yeah, they do.
Get out and have a good time with them. Play with your kids. All right. It makes the they know what to do. Just basically right. follow along.
Right.
I promise it's probably going to help you get in a better shape physically as well. You
Let
know, go through
lead.
Obstacle course with them. Right.
Yeah, they can
you
teach.
Know, powerful. Mm-hmm. All right. So that's number one. Let's move on to number two. So number two on our list of five things that kids can teach us about living a happy, healthy life. Number two is that kids are better able to let things go.
That's right? For sure.
They're better able to let things go. Now, this was actually the thing right here. This is the first thing that I monitored with Brayden that contributed to this show happening today is the fact that he doesn't harbor ill feelings. Like, something negative might happen. He might be sad. He might be upset. He might be angry. If he gets in, quote, trouble. But just within a few minutes, like, he's good.
Right.
And it's amazing to see because I'm feeling bad.
Right.
Like, maybe I'm thinking about different things and I want him to be happy, of course. But I'm also doing the parenting, you know.
Right. Right.
And so, but he's like, on to the next. Like, it's as if it never happened.
Isn't that priceless? How much life is not wasted on regret and disappointment that they can move on? You know, I don't remember where I learned this, but I think I do. It was our guy, Hal. Our pal, Hal.
Shout out to Hal.
Yes.
We'll put that episode in the show notes.
Please do, because he could have lamented over several things and was for a period of time. Mm-hmm. And then at some point he says, okay, I'm going to give myself 3 more days to deal with that, and then I'm done. And then he narrowed it down. Well, why 3 days? Mm. Well, how about four, you know, 1 day?
Yeah.
5 minutes.
5 minutes.
You're
going to
be bothered with
this?
About. 5 minutes is all you get.
Yeah.
And then you move on.
Yeah.
And kids do that automatically.
Right.
But we really need to recover that, you know?
Yeah. And it's a simple decision. Now, I want to make this clear. It's very healthy to experience all of your emotions.
For sure.
All right. We're not talking about suppressing anger or sadness or anything like that. It's healthy to experience all of your emotions. That's why you have them.
Mm-hmm.
They're a great gauge for direction in your life. All right. What this is really about is carrying negative emotions around in your tissues.
That's right.
And harboring ill feelings, because it will inherently bring you some pretty negative consequences.
Baggage.
So one study conducted by psychologists from the Harvard School of Public Health and the University of Rochester found that suppressing emotions can increase the risk of dying from heart disease and certain forms of cancer.
That's right. You got to unpack that.
Did you?
You got to unpack that. Yeah, it's killing you.
Powerful, man.
Right,
and it's right there again. Maybe that might be the catalyst. Of like, let me analyze this, because I'm just walking around. I'm the Grinch that stole Christmas.
Mm-hmm. You used a
I like Christmas.
And I love Christmas, right? You used a powerful quote before about forgiveness.
Yes.
Share that with us.
Nelson
again.
Mandela.
Mm-hmm.
He said that carrying resentment is like drinking poison, expecting your enemy to die from it.
Right.
All right. And a lot of us are doing this unconsciously. You know, we obviously wouldn't want to be hurting ourselves when we're having these ill feelings or carrying this resentment and negative experience that we're carrying around from other people.
Right.
And it's not to negate that these negative things have happened.
Right, but look at your research.
It's guaranteed that it's hurting you. Mm-hmm. It's hurting you.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to look at that. Just be aware of the fact that I have this issue with this person, but I'm hurting myself. And what that is, what it's usually banking on, is the fact that I hope that they change and make it right.
Yeah.
All right. When it doesn't work like that in reality, all right, chances are it will never happen. All right. And if it does, it could just be a bonus sandwich. right? But in reality, it's you taking responsibility for your feelings and how you're carrying yourself in the world, right? Because the fact that we are part of this human family and the fact that we are all here together, I guarantee you people are going to do stuff that you don't want them to do.
Right.
Right? It's just the nature of the game because, again, you're controlling to your fingertips. And it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing because that helps us to learn how to engage and to communicate. But the most important thing is us being able to communicate with ourselves.
Yeah.
And to be honest about how we feel and to process things. Mm-hmm. All right. So again, that study should be pretty jarring.
That makes me think of imagination. You know, when we used to be able to come up with all kinds of stuff just with our imagination.
Seriously, do you have ESPN? Because
get out of here.
The worldwide leader in sports. All right, so let's move on to number three. Since Jay just happened to know what's coming up next.
I don't know.
On our list of the five things that kids can teach us about living a happy, healthy life. Number three is using your imagination.
Get out of here.
Using your imagination. So how important is this? I remember in a special moment for myself in having Bob Proctor on the show. And we dove in, and he made this was like the number one thing for him.
Yeah.
And talking about, he's incredibly successful. He's impacted the lives of so many people and helped to brought about more health, wealth, beautiful relationships by following his work. Mm-hmm. All right. And so he was, a lot of people know him from being one of the stars of the movie, The Secret, but he's been doing this stuff for like 50 years.
Right.
All right?
Right.
And he's still got that swag. I mean, we talked to him. He's like, I'm 80,
right,
and I'm just getting started.
That's what
he
said.
He's got this vitality in life. He's like, I've got things to do, and the energy that he has is more so than what you might see in a 30-year-old or somebody even in their 20s. You know, it's fascinating and amazing to see. And he said that imagination is really the catalyst and the core of living a successful life is accessing that capacity that we have. And here's a study, and this was conducted by Harvard researchers. And they found that memory loss is linked to loss of imagination.
Not the other way around.
Tell me you haven't heard this before, because you haven't heard this before.
I mean,
right?
I haven't heard this before.
So memory loss is linked to a loss of imagination. So what they did, there's neuroimaging studies suggested that when people imagine themselves in the future, they use similar brain mechanisms as when recalling a memory, all right? So using that imagination has that same channel that keeps that alive. And what was so fascinating about this study was that it just kind of pointed me back to the fact that I love this word, imagineering, right? The Disney terminology.
Yep. Imagineers.
And we have this amazing, enormous capacity to sculpt our lives and to form our lives. And we have this amazing gift that oftentimes we don't take advantage of. And I love this quote from Einstein. He said that imagination is more important than knowledge.
Wow.
Knowledge is limited.
And he said this.
Knowledge is limited. Imagination encircles the world.
Okay. Right? That.
Incredibly powerful. And so he also said this, the true sign of intelligence is not knowledge, but imagination.
Well, see.
All right, again, kind of smart guy.
Well, if you're smart, that's what we labeled him as.
If you're smart in like your class, your classroom, people might say you're an Einstein.
Right. Right?
He's like, you get the nickname of
that. Right.
So this is the person it's coming from. And what he would do is these imagination experiments. This is how he broke down so many different things about how the universe works. Right. Imagination experiments. Powerful. And how often are you using your imagination to forecast, to see things differently than they are, you know, to future cast.
Yeah.
All right.
Give me that. Give me that word.
And also you can use your imagination as a tool to go back and even restructure memories that you have and change the experience. Mm-hmm. Literally, you can change your experience. You can go back and scratch up the CD of a negative experience.
That's
This is something that is used clinically. And so just say there was a bad fight or something that you had with a loved one, and maybe they've passed away and you can't heal that wound and you love them dearly. You can go back and change that experience. You can say the things you want to say in your mind, and it literally changes it. Your brain doesn't really know the difference. All right. So that's one thing. And I see you tearing up a little
bit here. Not tearing. Okay, a little tearing, but in a joyful way because yes. I'd like that. And I was feeling so fortunate, and I've spoken about this. It's still recent. So my grandmother just passed.
Yeah.
And I kept feeling some regret that I didn't do more or stand up for her more. Or, you know, we were all tired at one point, and she might have asked for a tissue or something. Yeah. I might have been like, oh. And I beat myself up over that sigh. Like, how did I show her that? But in other words, you know, I could go back to memories when too many of us were calling her name, Granny, Granny, Granny. She'd say, what? You know, and it tickled me because she's like, yeah. What? What you calling me for? Any other time, it's yes, baby. But she'd go, you know, if we were getting in there. But to have that capacity to do so, I think would also honor her, but be a much more valuable use of our memory of her, you know. So I felt that.
Yes, I saw it. I saw it.
You know me too well. Get out of here.
Another thing that this can do, and thank you for sharing that. Another thing that this can do is it can help you to see the other options of how things actually are showing up in the world, because we become so fixed in our opinion and we don't know that we're doing this. So another example is maybe it's a tragic situation or abusive situation with a parent where there's neglect or something like that. And you're very fixed in that. And that's your reason for, I can't because my mother didn't hug me enough, or, you know, my parent was abusive. And so this is why I am the way that I am. Mm-hmm. And we can start to change that perception, because oftentimes we unknowingly think that it's our fault.
Sure.
All right. And we're not analyzing the fact that it was a disorder within them, the other person.
Right.
So you're carrying that, you're carrying that negativity. And what you can do is, by using your imagination, you can see the bigger picture. You can see, like, wait a minute. Well, my parent was abused. Mm-hmm. My parent was kicked out of the house, or whatever the case may be. You can start to see the other parts and see that it wasn't my fault.
Right.
It wasn't my fault that they did this certain thing to me. It's just a different way to free yourself.
That's incredible what you just said. What it communicates to me is that we're imagining the one that we've attached to anyway. Because essentially, and I learned this in a landmark forum, that the event happens. You know, the thing is the thing. Shawn threw a pin across the room, right?
And it's like just stabbed you in the jugular.
No, I didn't go that deep, okay. But gee whiz.
All right, I'm sorry.
Okay, he just threw the pin. And
it was a highlighter.
Okay, but jugular? That could poison me. You got me. The point is, throwing the pen across the room is just the thing, but we attach the meaning. We determine that that means, oh, he doesn't care about me, or, oh, that means that we're going to be in a fight for the rest of the day. Mm. We imagine that.
Yeah.
So therefore, we should have the freedom to attach whatever meaning we want to it or not.
Yeah.
It just is the thing. He threw the pen. Oops.
She just literally hit me with the pen.
But did it mean anything?
It means I'm going to get you. I received that pen hit.
Right.
So, you know, when you said this, I mean, it's beautiful, beautiful observation.
Mm-hmm.
But when you said that I threw a pen at you, I thought about the movie Old School with Will Ferrell.
Yeah.
And when he got hit with the dart in the neck. If you haven't seen that movie, don't see it. It's not appropriate for everybody.
For anyone.
But he got hit with that dart. He's messing around with the dart gun for the pets or whatever. And he got hit. He's like, there's a dart in my neck. You're crazy. You're funny. I like you, but you're crazy.
And
he just started to slur. Anyways,
right.
It just
but
all played in my mind.
That didn't have to mean, you know, or even, well, let's take that further, because he could have said, you're an idiot. You know, just like if we do things, we attach the additional meaning to it with ourselves and with others, and we get to choose.
Yeah.
And we don't have to carry any of that. It just is what it is.
Yeah. And then let's talk a little bit about it in more of a positive light, because
sure.
Now we're talking about
you got me all down
processing.
Where's the play in
negative
that?
Experiences, but seeing possibility.
Yeah. Ooh.
And this is why kids, they have so much freedom. If you just... They're not thinking about their phone bill or any, like, there's so much freedom there. They're not carrying stress, you know? It's just amazing to be around that. If you pay attention to it, some of that's going to rub off on you. It's like some kind of, it's intangible, but it's so visceral. Like, you can't really explain it. If you just pay attention, you pick that up. How can you tap back into that power that you have within yourself to see bigger, to see more, to see smaller, to change your perspective?
To see hues.
To imagineer your own life.
Yeah.
All right, because you have this opportunity right now. You are the star of your own movie.
Mm-hmm. Not to say that there aren't improv artists.
Congratulations. Right. There are people.
They're there.
You might have even a long time ago passed the starring role, tried to offer somebody, like, here's a script, you do it.
Right.
And we do that with our health.
Ooh.
Right?
Yeah.
You do it for me. Mm-hmm. When in reality, you are the star. You're the star. So being the star of your own movie, you get to write this script, all right? Be a little bit more creative, all right? You don't have to follow the cookie cutter. You don't have to stay in the box that society's put you in. Some of the greatest people who've influenced our society have seen outside of that box.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're the ones who are imagineering where we are, the life that we have today.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, the world was flat.
Right.
Like you.
To everyone.
This was taught in universities.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Straight. This is bananas. Right.
Right.
And also, I mean, you take it a step further to the realization that the Earth isn't at the center of our galaxy.
Right.
All right.
Right.
Of our of this universe. It's not the center that the sun is.
Right.
Like literally people got killed for that.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. And then we move to cooler things like flying. Right. The Wright brothers, you know, and just if this was going on 200 years ago and you see a plane flying by, like that's Thor, you know?
Thor's coming.
And so, but they saw beyond what is,
yeah.
And now we can literally connect and travel and with the internet, we can connect with anybody anywhere at any time. Very
Doesn't
powerful.
That just blow you away, like right now on our podcast?
And it happened all in our lifetime.
It has.
You know?
Like even on this podcast, like, there's someone who's listening right now, connecting with us.
Yeah.
One, who knows from where, but days away,
depending
on when they listen to it, or like the last review. I've been listening since a year or two ago, as if it's right now. It's just amazing. We have
powerful.
To learn how to, what was the saying? Color outside of the lines.
Mm.
Yeah.
Shout out to coloring.
Dude.
It's another thing we do together, Braden and I.
Let's get some crayons.
You know? So, and by the way, I just want to make clear when I said this is all happening in our lifetime, we're talking about the internet. We're not talking about flying. Okay.
We're
not vampires.
Right, right.
It's not Team Edward, Team Jacob.
I remember DOS. I was around as DOS was
the
going
floppy
out.
Disk, man.
That's right.
Even when I was in college, I had that.
I did.
So, and I mean, back in the day, it's like even to talk to somebody on, you know, this, in a different continent, let alone in another state, but a different continent, like it is timed. Mm-hmm. You got to be right there. You're watching the clock.
Right.
Long distance call, like the what was it? The phone call, phone cards. What were
yes,
they called?
I remember they're phone cards.
Phone cards.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You know, so look, I don't even know what it
right.
what it is. You know, and so literally somebody in the UK just called me like yesterday.
See.
You know, it's just like you pick up the phone and you dial, and
right
it's just right there. And
place and time has been
unlimited cell phone minutes
reimagined.
Powerful.
Yes.
Powerful.
What is now, a cell phone? Let's imagine.
What is air? She takes a deep breath.
Right.
Congratulations. I just gave you some air.
You did.
No, that's how we even treat each other.
Yeah.
You know, if you give me love, I'll give you some air.
Right.
I'm sorry.
Like, some treat.
You're swimming in air already, you know. Finding ways to have people do what you want them to do when in reality, you have access to all of these things to use your imagination, your ability to forgive, to let go, to move on, use your ability to play.
At any
and this is
moment.
Just part of what we're covering today. And I want to give you guys a quick shout out to something that Jade is sipping on that she keeps looking at.
Not just looking, baby.
I wish people could see. She's drinking the lion's mane tea that she snuck out of my
box. I saw the box and I went for it.
My four-stigmatic lion's mane mushroom elixir. And this is what I had this morning. Whenever I know that I'm going to do something that's requiring that extra mental juice, I'm using my lion's mane tea. So
now that I know, I sure will too. This is good.
So here's what's so cool about it. So lion's mane is currently being increasingly studied for its neuroprotective effects. All right, we're talking about all this powerful thing, all these powerful things with the brain from our activity in the world. What about our nutrition? And there's very few things that are neuroprotective. I mean, broccoli's awesome. Kale is awesome. But this particular power, and this is why there's so much research being done right now. And so there's two specific classes of nerve growth factor. All right, so nerve growth factor, you know what it's doing.
Can't be bad there.
All right, growing nerves.
Mm-hmm.
And these are specific molecules that stimulate differentiation. So having cells become the right things that they need to become. So this gets into a whole conversation about stem cells and their ability to become different things.
Mm-hmm.
That's a whole other conversation for another day. We'll do a show about it for sure. But this differentiation is very important. So cells are doing and being the things that they need to be. And also, it's found that lion's mane can help the remyelination of neurons. Myelination, remyelination. So laying down of that insulation so the nerves fire faster. So whether it's you being able to shoot the basketball off one foot, you know, falling out of bounds like Steph Curry, you know, because he's done it so many times and laid down that pathway, that's myelination, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or it's something as simple as just being able to remember names, you know, being able to remember a phone number. Mm-hmm. Who even knows?
Well,
the
there's
phone
a guy.
Right now?
I know, right? At all, you don't need.
You
to.
Might know your phone number,
mm-hmm.
but that's
don't
about
ask.
It.
Don't ask me what's the number. Hold on, let me get my phone. You know, and I'll look it up. But there's a guy who you could show him the dollar bill, and he could remember the serial code of several of them in the room.
Excuse me, you know Jim Quick, right?
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, come on. So Jim is the one
Bring
who really
that. Yes.
put me on to the fact that we are becoming lazy. We're outsourcing our brains to our devices.
Wow.
You know, and so I've seen Jim in a room full of people take 100. So he'll literally got a microphone, pass it around, 100 people say a number, all right? And he'll remember the whole thing front, going one way and backwards. He can recite it.
That's right. Unbelievable.
Crazy.
What
crazy
a brain.
Stuff. Yeah. But and this is the thing.
Myelination.
He's like, Shawn, anybody can do it. I'm just like,
yeah, right.
Whatever, dude.
Okay, exactly.
But he has helped me so much in uh-huh. different things and even being able to remember names, for
mm-hmm.
example.
Mm-hmm.
I'm fantastic at that. And I bring it to other people, like as a little quiz. I mess with people all the time. Like, somebody comes into a group and we're standing around and like, oh, this is such and such and such. And I'm like, what are our names? Like, I'll immediately put them on the spot, and then they'll maybe get like two.
Right.
And then I'll share with them the mental exercise that Jim taught me. And of course, we're going to have him back on the show.
Yes.
And guys, if you haven't heard the Superhero Brain Conference episode, we'll put that in the show notes. Powerhouse.
So
powerhouse.
So good.
So,
and he gave us a little
You get free access to
mm-hmm.
that, which,
mm-hmm.
I mean, people came from all over the world, paid thousands of dollars to attend. You get access to that free. But just go back and check out that episode. We'll put that in the show
notes. That's the cost.
So
you'll like that. You'll be glad.
Here's another thing. So mice were actually injected in this particular study with a neurotoxic peptide in an experiment to assess the effects of lion's mane on the type of amyloid plaque formation that's seen in Alzheimer's patients.
Mm-hmm.
They found that the reduction of beta amyloid plaques in the brains of the mushroom-fed, the lion's mane-fed mice versus the mice not fed any mushrooms was remarkable. Like, it was night and day difference. This was so protective
mm-hmm.
from toxicity, from putting toxic compounds that quite possibly contribute to Alzheimer's into these mice. This protected them
mm-hmm.
from coming down with this disease, from developing more of this beta amyloid plaque, all right? Powerful, powerful stuff.
Is.
So
definitely
head over and check out this lion's mane tea. Go to foursigmatic.com. So that's foursigmatic.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so that's four. So that's like the number four, but spelled out, sigmatic.com. And use the checkout code MODELHEALTH. And you're going to get 15% off. That's right, 15%.
Okay.
You're welcome.
Thank
you're
you. Because
no,
I
this
need
is,
a box of my own.
Here's what's so fascinating and powerful about this is that it's dual extracted. All right, so it's dual extracted. So that means they're extracting with alcohol. Did you just do a Slurpee?
Mm-mm.
You just did a Slurpee
mm-mm.
on the MODELHEALTH show.
Mm-mm.
It's all right. I'm not gonna carry that. Yeah, take it in.
Yeah.
So they do a dual extraction, which is alcohol extracted and also hot water extracted. So you're able to pull all the different compounds, the triterpenes, the beta glucans, all these things are going to be pulled from the mushroom with different modalities. If you're just using one, you're not getting all the good stuff out of it. Mm-hmm. So they do a dual extraction, and they give you these very handy dandy packets, man, to make it instant. Just hot water,
and
boom.
Easy.
You've
just
got a powerful brain elixir,
yes,
lion's mane. And you know that I love the chaga as well. I love the reishi. Their mushroom coffees. My wife goes ham sandwich on those.
Yeah.
Like she hasn't, our whole relationship, one time I saw her drink coffee once while we were in college.
Uh-huh.
Right. Since then, I haven't seen her drink coffee, mm-hmm, a single time. She's, mm-hmm, been more of a hot chocolate girl.
Right.
Hot chocolate lady. But she loves the mushroom coffee.
Oh, yeah.
And she'll have it in the morning, you know, pre-workout. She'll generally have that with some healthy fat, some MCT oil, that kind of thing. And that's her peanut butter and jam.
Oh, yeah.
She really loves it.
Well,
and there's no crash. That's what's so powerful about it. And the alkalinity of the mushrooms helps to balance that acidity of the coffee, because coffee can tear your system up if you're not careful.
Yeah. Wow.
And just incredible stuff. Head over, check them out. foursigmatic.com. Coupon code modelhealth, 15% off. So now let's go on to number four here on our list of the five things kids can teach us about living a happy, healthy life. And we've already covered number one, playing full out. Number two, letting it go. Number three, using your imagination. And number four is kids ask a lot of questions.
Yeah.
All right, kids ask a lot of questions. So why does this matter with our health and our well-being and our happiness? Well, this brings me back to the episode we did with Jay Papazan, all right, the co-author of The One Thing,
yes,
the monster hit best-selling book.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, to get the big answers, because we all want those big answers, mm-hmm, in life, to get the big answers, you need to ask big questions.
Yep.
You need to ask big questions. And our brains are hardwired. When a child asks those questions, it's hardwired. We are hardwired to seek answers, whether you realize it or not. Reticular cortex, look up these parts of your brain if you're interested. Reticular activating system. Reticular cortex is scanning your environment to find data based on what you're holding most dominant in your thoughts. All right. So if you're focused on all the problems with everything, you're just going to look around. You're going to see more problems to affirm what you're looking for.
Right.
All right. Conversely, and of course, there's a great example. If you get a new car, you'll start to see that car
everywhere,
all over the place, because your brain is now associated. It has this thing that's top of mind.
Mm-hmm.
So now you start to see it more frequently. So asking questions points your reticular activating system, these different parts of your brain, in the direction of discovery. How can I find the answer to this thing? Immediately it starts to happen. And kids, they just want to know everything,
mm-hmm,
right? And it can be a little bit annoying,
uh-huh,
of course. It's like, why?
Right.
Why this? Why that?
Right.
What is this? What
right.
is that? You know, but it's their little brains, mm-hmm, just seeking and trying to gather information to answer these big questions for them.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
They're big for them. They want those details, you know? So what's for dinner?
Oh.
How did you make that? Oh, where'd that come from?
You know how many times I've like finessed and kind of Rico Suave'd out of where did I come from?
Right?
It's not that I'm not going to give him
at some point
specific breakdown of it, but when he's like 3 and 4.
Or are you going to be
it's
specific?
Like, well, I mean.
You say that. I tried. Once they got me cornered, I started singing The Lion King, The Circle of Life. I didn't know where to go.
So currently, he thinks, thanks to his older brother, he thinks that he was in my pocket. He came from my pocket.
That's hilarious.
Or his mom's purse. So my pocket, mom's purse.
Hilarious.
This is, I don't know how this turned so quickly to this subject matter.
Yeah.
Right, imagineering. And he's just like,
possible.
Okay. He's good with that. Because here's the thing. Here's the question he always asks. When he sees something like an older picture or we might talk about an older experience. He's like, where was I at?
Mm-hmm. Mm.
Oh, wow.
That's
it
moving.
Just immediately opens me up
right.
to like, man, this is what an incredible thing.
Right.
What an incredible thing.
Mm-hmm.
Where were you?
Right.
Because there's some kind of existence there already that animates all of us.
Mm-hmm.
And it's so powerful to think about it. And he helps me to ask those bigger questions.
I love the question he asked because he was already on the way, but we didn't know.
And of course, guys, I'm a scientist, so I'm not just
you're
like,
all hardcore,
you were in my pocket. Yeah. I told him, your mom and I, we made you. And that's
Ooh,
kind of
good answer.
And he didn't go any further in that because then I finessed out of.
He's gonna say, "What did you make me out of?" See, yeah.
So anywho,
but I will use that one actually. That might do a little better than the Simba analogy I did.
Oh my goodness! Shout out to Timon and Pumbaa.
Yeah, Hakuna. All right.
So ask questions. All right, ask questions. Mm-hmm. Questions are really the navigator of our lives. All right. Your life goes in the direction of the questions that you ask. So are you asking disempowering questions every day? And chances are, if you're not acclimated to this type of information and what we're doing here with the Model Health Show, and you're new to the team,
welcome.
And shout out to you. Thank you so much for being a part of this mission with us. But this Model Health Show team knows that we are incredibly powerful and endowed with capabilities to change our life and ask more empowering questions. But just going on in the background for a lot of us still, and this happens for all of us from time to time, is why me?
Mm-hmm.
Why is this happening to me? Why won't somebody help me? Why won't this, you know, why did this bad thing happen mm-hmm. to me? And your brain immediately, because it's seeking to answer questions, it's going to use your immense power to find reasons why things are messed up.
I got one for you. How come I can't?
Ooh, yeah.
Why don't I have?
Yeah.
That how come I can't? You just sealed it right there. Can't, cannot happen. I try to encourage folks when they use the word can't. That's just an acronym that you can try. Mm. Just finish it out.
Mm.
See that T a little like further. That. You can try.
Yes.
You know?
Yes, I love that. And you're using your immense power. In essence, wasting it away, because these minutes are precious. Asking disempowering questions that aren't going to give you that fulfillment that you're looking for. So ask a better question. Ask a bigger question. So I love this particular question that I ask when I'm in a trouble spot or somebody that I love intimately, like really, this is so powerful for me. And I've seen this recently with somebody that I love and seeing some suffering. And there's a place for it because when it's like hot, like it's acute pain, it's hard to look at the bigger picture, right? But after a little bit of like, we create rapport, calm down, let's be a little, like, let's talk about this a little bit. Ask, what is this trying to teach me? What is this trying to teach me? Okay, you could take this a step further and ask, you know, what is it that I need to become? Who is it that I need to become? What qualities is this experience trying to draw out of me? And you're going to have something there. Something is going to manifest itself. You're going to be presented with an answer. And that answer then leads to the action that you need to take in the world. All right? So again, these questions are guiding and governing, navigating our lives. It is that powerful.
It's
so ask
powerful.
Bigger questions.
Mm.
Instead of how come I can't, ask how can I?
Yep.
How can I write a best-selling book?
Get that.
What is it that I need to do to write a best-selling book? What is it that I need to do to have the relationship that I really want? Who do I need to become? All right, ask bigger questions, ask more empowering questions, and you will get more empowering answers. So that's number four, ask lots of questions. It is your power. Kids are good at it. We're not so much. So ask lots of questions. Now we're at number five. So this is our last one. I hope you guys have enjoyed this.
Oh
I know
goodness,
that I have.
Yes.
So very, very excited because I'm just, as I'm doing this, I'm thinking about all those moments with my son and him being this, all of this
right,
naturally.
Right.
All right. So our list of five things kids can teach us about living a happy, healthy life. Number five is to be persistent with what you want.
Love it.
Be persistent with what you want. Kids don't throw in the towel that easily.
No, they don't.
Right? When they have their eyes on something, when they have their mindset on something, they're going to find a way to get to it. They're going to go for it. And of course, out of protection for our kids, we often are telling them no and to talk them out of things. And many times that's justified. But they are still there calculating, how can I get that thing that I want?
Right.
And they're persistent about it. This is another place that they'll ask that question, why?
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you're like, no, you can't do that. Why?
Right. And
I
that
really...
'cause I said so doesn't cut it for them anymore. And really, I think you just You helped me realize something with the children in that point specifically, but also if it's something that we're trying to recall or restore in ourselves, what can I be doing by asking this big question? How can I help my children now strengthen and fortify that within themselves so that when they are adults, it's not so much a challenge to try to recoup it? So if they are being persistent, instead of just shutting them down, how can I nurture that so that they're going to continue to ask the questions and keep seeking and staying persistent and not get dissuaded when it's something they want and think that their circumstances or the world around them will dictate whether or not they can have it?
Yeah, I love that. Mm-hmm. I think it first always starts with you being the example, okay? So for a lot of being persistent with what we want, if our kids witness us doing it, they'll have more of a natural tendency to do that.
Sure.
This is the whole nature versus nurture. It's both because we, like I said earlier, when I see my son, it's there, right? But also nurturing that so that it expresses itself. So I think that's the first and foremost. And as far as that takes grace.
Yeah, it does.
You know, that takes grace because we're in this position of being the caregivers and protectors for our kids, but also not living their life for them, you know, and it's finding those graceful spots. And I think it's a great opportunity for us to ask questions of them in those moments, you know, just to have a conversation instead of shutting them down, you know.
I met a mom and she was just delightful and dynamic. And one of the questions she asks her daughter when she asks something outrageous or wants to, that she considers outrageous, it may not be for her child. And she's a teenager, 13, 14 years old. Mom, I want to go jump out of an airplane without a parachute. And her mom asks this question and it stays with me. She says, what would that mean? What would that look like for you? Or what would that mean for you? So that her child could start to process and think it through instead of saying, no, that's ridiculous. Don't do it.
Yeah.
Or absolutely not.
Yeah.
And then with a younger child, I remember being told if the child said, hey, mommy, I want an elephant for a pet. And as opposed to absurd, you know, shutting it down. That's interesting. Tell me more.
Yeah.
And that gives them
or
some
move
room.
To Thailand.
Or right.
Whatever. Shout out to Hung Bak.
I started thinking of Mowgli.
Shout out to Tony Jaa.
There you
yes.
go. Right. But there are ways and there's grace in that. But when you exercise that grace, here's what's cool. It takes imagination for that.
Yes. Yeah.
It takes aligning yourself with who they are, where they are. So there's another educational piece that the child gives you. You're doing this, learning this from your children. But in that grace, you become something more and greater than that space, that limit, that line, and those boundaries that you were in just by you having not thought of that yourself. You know? They brought that to you. So it's a great place to have a beautiful exchange.
Right.
I love that you observed Braden so we can look more closely. You're inspiring me.
Thank you.
I will be watching them.
Thank you.
Yes.
Wow. Thank you for sharing that too. And I just want to encourage this kind of wrap up for this particular piece, being persistent with what you want.
Yes, sir.
The only surefire way to not get to the destination that you want to get to is by giving up. All right. Fight for your dreams. Keep walking towards them. They're yours. All right. And the crazy thing is, even as I'm saying the word fight, you don't have to even fight. Like the universe is conspiring to help you. There are going to be challenges. There are going to be bumps along the way. There are going to be obstacles. But they are there to develop those qualities in you to actually have what you think you want to have.
Yes.
Right? Are you the type of person that's capable of having a number one best-selling book and all that that entails? Right? These things are there to develop those qualities in you. And they're such a great gift. Right? So right now is your opportunity to be persistent in what you want, all right? No looking back. We don't have to look back at what how you were before. Today you have the opportunity, and we need you to do that, all right? You have gifts, capacities, talents, insights, experience that we need today, all right? The scales can shift from time to time in the overall dynamic of our society and our culture, and this is a time for people to step up who are living, breathing, walking, talking examples of health, of vitality, of joy, of living on purpose, of living the life that you are here to live. All right. We need examples like that. And I need you to step up and do this along with me, because I'm definitely going to continue to do that. And I hope that you got a lot of value out of this episode today. This is something that is very personal and hits home for me. And I truly believe that our kids have, I almost broke into, I believe that you did not. Shout out.
Teach them well and let them lead the way.
Shout out to all the assemblies in middle school and elementary school.
Michael Jordan, I believe I can fly.
Oh, yeah, that one. And Man in the Mirror, we did that one in fourth
Come
grade.
Come on, you got to do it.
Listen, this is a real true story. Fourth grade, we did the Man in the Mirror.
Yeah.
After
Were
class.
You Michael?
I think I told you this.
No.
I think we talked about this maybe on a past episode, but then in fourth grade, I was starting to be a little bit of a cut up in class, all right? And I was I got into an agreement with the teacher that after the class was over, I would be able to present to the class and do what I wanted to do. So it might have been just, and it was me and my friend, and it was me and my best friend. And it might have been we just up there kind of clowning around, talking, or we would sing, all right? And so I would get into it, all right? And so the assembly, Man in the Mirror, we're all singing as a class. We're all doing our thing. Teacher hands me the microphone in the middle. I spun. I did a spin, dropped down on the knees. Boom, hit it. Fame started right then, all right? Fourth grade, fifth grade girls.
You sewed it up right there. That's right. Fourth and fifth. See, you scored a upperclassman. Look at that.
So everybody, thank you so much for tuning into the show today. I truly, truly appreciate you. And just remember, look to our children. Pay attention to them. They are walking, talking reflections of what we are and what's possible for us. They have many lessons to teach us just as we're teaching them. All right. So I appreciate you so much. Have an amazing day, and I'll talk with you soon.